This is the regular planning board meeting. Second Monday in October, October the 10th, 2022. We've established a quorum. We look first usually for an approval of the agenda, but I do have one item I would like to add to the agenda that was emailed to you the other day, and that is amending the rules of procedure allowing committees of this board to meet virtually. So I'd like to add that to the agenda. A discussion to amend the rules of procedure allowing committees of this board to meet virtually. And that would be presented to City Council and the city attorney for approval.
Why do we want to meet virtually? See everybody's face.
Well, committees, we'll have a discussion. I'm not talking about board meetings. I'm talking about committees.
I'll move to approve the agenda as amended.
Second. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Second item on the agenda is approval of the minutes from the September 12th meeting. Everybody's had a chance to read those. And
I'll move to approve the minutes as distributed last week.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Aye. Okay. Very good. Under new business, we are going to talk about recommendation to City Council for a comprehensive plan consultant, 2045 comprehensive plan consultant. Go ahead, Matt.
Yeah, I'll just note on it. On the agenda, we had a rezoning for the Lakewood Apartments that was essentially deemed incomplete for a couple of reasons. Their TIA, once it was submitted and reviewed, had a large number of technical revisions needed. So we essentially deemed that it wasn't in a good enough state to be thoroughly reviewed in order to determine outcomes and if any mitigation was needed. And then there were some issues with their fire access and meeting the Appendix D of the fire code, which was going to result in potential changes to their site plan. So because they were within a certain time frame of this meeting, that by code was required to be deferred to the next meeting. So that's why that's under new business. And then under other business, can you pull that PowerPoint? It should be downloaded. So as you guys know, we've been going through the process of issuing an RFP and receiving proposals and reviewing proposals for the 2045 comprehensive plan. That RFP was released at the beginning of August. Deadline was August 31st. We received five proposals from the firms listed on the screen there. And we initiated a review process, and that started with an internal staff team that we developed a scoring sheet, which this is an example here, where you're weighting and grading under different criteria. The criteria came from what was listed in the RFP, things that we're evaluating to determine whether they would be the right fit or not, and then some space for notes on the right side of the page. And each internal staff member went through this process and filled out this scoring sheet. And all those scores and grades were then compiled. And so we had two folks from planning, Tyler and I, Jamie from downtown, Mark Steerwalt from Public Works, and Brent Detweiler from engineering. Those were the reviewers. And Lou, if you don't mind moving the location of the, So these were tabulated and we got these averages. They're all really tight, right? And that really was obvious from reviewing the proposals and speaking with some of these folks. Any of these teams they're all competent with teams with lots of great experience, and it'd be hard to go the wrong way. You can click on the screen. So we're really looking at the nuances of each of these things. And so we went through, we discussed the findings. In particular, Bolton and Mink was one of the lower scoring when we just did the evaluation of the proposals, part of that was in large part due to their budget. Their pricing was higher than everyone else. And Lou did not do the scoring sheet, but he has kind of a little bit higher authority than the rest of us. And so he pointed out that this price tag, they had mentioned flexibility within their budget, and the scope and scale of the project would make an impact on the pricing, and essentially conveyed that they could work within our budget. And so that little difference in scoring makes a big difference because they were so close. All the firms were so close. So with that information, we decided to interview them along with two other candidates. I'm sorry, Lou, the Zoom keeps blocking some of the information here. You might want to switch seats. I've got you doing so much over there. Sorry about that. So Bolton & Mink, as I mentioned, Housel Levine was another firm that internal staff folks were interested in speaking with, and TSW with their sub-consultants as well. So we set up interviews for those folks. We shared the proposals from those three. So we went from five to three, shared the three proposals with our long-range planning committee. They had time to review those and got to dive into those proposals. And then we convened. Then the next step was to have interviews. And so based on, looks like this got cut off somehow, but the interview involved the internal staff team that I mentioned, and then the chairman was also involved in the interviews. And so after those interviews, we reconvened the internal planning staff and the long range committee and had a final discussion. This is where things sat, and here's where we felt, this is how we felt about the proposals. Here's the additional feedback we got through the interview process, and here's where we've landed. Lou, can you minimize that image? It's an image, a screenshot of the, if you can click on the, yeah, I'm not sure. Yeah, I think that must be the whole thing. And so what it came down to was essentially that one of the TSW, one of the consultants was, there were a couple of aspects that they didn't mention. They didn't really convey much experience locally. That was a big one. I don't think they touched much on economic development. And in general, there was the impression that that they were not as enthusiastic relative to some of the other teams. And so that was one that everyone kind of had a consensus on. The next two, Housel Levine and Bolton & Mink, good, healthy discussion amongst everyone. There's a lot to like about both of these firms. Housel Levine, based out of the Midwest, out of Chicago. Some of the looking at the nuances, some of the concerns were about, the impact on community engagement that may have, travel times, condensed schedules. They also didn't convey as much about community engagement and their strategies related to community engagement. And again, economic development was something that they didn't mention or talk about in terms of their strategies related to that chapter, which was a specific call out in the RFP. However, they had a ton of great knowledge. We had a really great conversation with them. They were very impressive, but they came down to be our second choice. Our top choice, Bolton & Mink, a very large team. This was actually another one of the concerns with this team was, how well can a large team work together? And what they conveyed in their interview was great camaraderie, great teamwork. The way that the presentations between the different members of the team, which are individual firms that focus on specific aspects of the comprehensive plan, and the folks from Bolton & Mink were able to hand off to the folks from Green Heron Planning and some of the others, retail strategies and what's that other small firm that's on their team? It's on the front of the.
It was on the front of the presentation.
Front of the proposal there. They've got a team of at least five total, four subs.
City Explained, Nylon.
City Explained. And so they're handing off through the presentation back and forth. They specifically called out changes in our population locally and how they would tailor their community engagement to those specific needs. The experience level on the team across the board was superior to some of the other choices. Some of the topics around growth management, which is going to be, you know, the topic for us with the amount of development pressure that we're under, their strategies for that, as well as economic development, transportation across the board. The guy, there was one gentleman that was involved in writing 160D for the state that's on their team. So their local knowledge, their North Carolina statutory knowledge is going to be above the others as well. And ultimately, I feel like they are a team that's going to be the most well received by the community because of that experience. I think it's going to convey. I think people are going to are going to want to engage with them as part of this process. And that's such a critical part, right, is getting the community feedback. And so that was the consensus of the Long Range Planning Committee and staff. I have since then reached out to some of the references that were listed. I got this email back from Cheryl with, she's the Chief Planning and Development Officer for the Center City Partners in Charlotte. She has some very favorable things to say and has a lot of experience with that team. I'm scheduled to speak with Alyssa from Charlotte, from the city of Charlotte, next week. And then I have yet to get a reply. Folks are busy from the downtown folks at Albemarle. But I'm continuing to work on that and hope to hear from everybody on this. And so we're doing our reference checks as well. And with that, I'll open it up. Jim, I don't know if you wanted to share anything.
Yeah.
I'm happy to talk about next steps and the process and where we go from here as well.
Sure. I will say that the long range committee met twice since our last planning board meeting. Chronologically, initially, we were shown the scoring sheet, how it was going to work, who was going to fill out those scoring sheets. Everybody on the committee felt comfortable with that. And then we were told that they would narrow it down to either two or three. It turned out to be three. And there would be an interview process. The committee nominated myself to be a part of those interviews. I volunteered, and the interviews were extensive. I mean, they lasted an hour and a half each, if not a little bit more. They were Zoom type calls, but you could see the folks that were involved. You could see their facial, because a lot of communication is done with facial expressions, body language. Yeah, and the folks at Bolton and Mink were overwhelmingly seemed very excited to work with us. Like, this was a project they really wanted to work on. They also, in their proposal itself, and then on the interview, they spent a lot of time talking about community engagement. They had done their homework. They knew that approximately 10% of our city population is Hispanic, and they knew that there might be a language barrier, and they were willing to hire translators to work with folks that might not otherwise have a voice. And they also talked about, how the Acosta Trail could be a game changer for our city. So they had really done their homework. At the end of the third interview, we all stayed on the call. And I guess because everybody else was on city staff, except for myself, and had done these scoring sheets, they asked for my input first. And I said, Bolton and Mink to me stood out above the others, and we very easily came to consensus. I mean, there was discussion, but most of the discussion was like, who are you going to rank number two, because in case things don't work out. So it was very easy to come to consensus there, which in my opinion meant that, you know, they did stand out. And that, and the other thing is too, being local, somewhat local, the partners they're working with are in Greenville, South Carolina. They themselves are in Charlotte, I believe. Is that correct? I've been on committees where we've worked with consultants before from out of town, and you get to the, you know, you're having a great discussion and all of a sudden somebody's looking at their watch because they've got to catch a plane. When you're driving to Charlotte or driving to Greenville, it's not as imperative as getting to the airport for a flight. So, you know, the folks in Chicago made a great presentation, but I think that needs to come into play. Somebody local, because they're not constantly, you know, coming to town and then looking at their watch right away. I think that's important. Any other?
I've got a question.
Sure.
What do you see the city, do we see, and do the consultants see as community engagement? How do you define that to the public?
Receiving feedback on the different topics that are being covered from the public.
So that means open meetings regularly?
It means a wide range or a full menu of different strategies to get people's voices heard.
So in other words, they talk about, you know, if we want the input from tourists about Hendersonville, you put iPads on Main Street and have a quick survey that tourists could take on Main Street. When you talk about the different communities, they're talking about little pop-up meetings and even
barbecues.
They're serving barbecue and getting folks input. And then there'd be meetings, obviously, in this room where you'd invite the public and they.
Online surveys.
Yeah, online
focus surveys, groups, stakeholder, individual stakeholder meetings, and committee meetings, that type of
thing. And including all of that in a 200,000K budget.
That's part of the scope. Now, the details of the community engagement, as well as some of these other things, I think the community engagement is probably the most or the biggest part that will need to be ironed out. I mean, I think there's probably a pretty good sense of what the deliverables are going to be for the same, you know, equal to the same level of input from our last comprehensive plan on all the topics, with the exception of transportation and the inclusion of economic development. So those are going to be beefed up a little bit more. And then an additional focus on downtown master planning is what it's been termed, but it may not be a full scale master plan, as well as it may not be a full scale comprehensive transportation plan, but additional detail in both of those areas, more so than we have now in our current comprehensive plan. And then what else am I missing? Those are going to be like really gauging what the scope of those extra detailed chapters are going to be, and the level of detail, the number of meetings, the configuration of a steering committee or focus groups, what, you know, that whole engagement process, what strategies are going to be used, how much time is going to be devoted to that would be part of the contract. So we'd be negotiating that, making sure we clearly understand and they clearly understand what's expected of them and what we're expecting for both engagement and the deliverables. And so at this stage, we're really identifying who we want to engage in that negotiation with, who out of the five is our top choice to then begin those conversations about a contract with.
What's the timeline for this? Once you choose a consultant, from initiation to end of contract?
Yeah, so at this stage, if the planning board feels comfortable and ready to make a recommendation tonight, that recommendation would go to City Council in November. November 3rd, City Council would make a decision if they supported the recommendation. Then that would then kick into gear this contract negotiation, and we'd work out that contract over the following through some point before the end of the year. And then during that phase, we're probably also talking about what does the initial kickoff look like, what does the analysis of existing conditions and research and data collection and all those front end types of efforts formulating surveys and things like that. They're working on all those things at the beginning. I think if I were to guess, and Lou, you weigh in, compared to other comprehensive plans, we are asking for more than is typical. And so I would think that the timeline would also be expected to be a little bit longer. So I'm thinking, I think we put in 18 to 24 months. Is that right?
Well, they have actually proposed to accomplish the comp plan in about a year process.
A year?
Yeah.
18 to 24
now, months. Will it take 18 months? Yeah, possibly. So that's based on, so basically what ends up happening is we're going to give you these deliverables at these points. Oftentimes then the community is going to respond and perhaps have additional feedback, and that can extend the timeline. But I would say 18 months is probably, you know, our goal to have a final comprehensive plan in front of planning board and then in front of city council for adoption.
In your opinion, all of the work you guys have done up to this point, up to right now, city council is probably going to go along with whatever you lay on the table. And seemingly you guys have really done the homework and feel comfortable about this particular group. So the decision that we make today is sort of moot, not quite, but
I mean,
because we got to say something.
But
you guys have done a a miraculous job for a really big project. And city council is going to go, oh, okay, you know, which is good. That's the way it's supposed to work. So you got any thoughts about that?
Well, I'll just say that, you know, one of the things that we really tried to do was put together a good process, spend time reviewing this and get it, doing some of that heavy lifting to get it to a point where the committee is looking at less, looking at a more refined group. And then same thing to this point where you're really just looking at the top choice to have some level of assurance that the process that's been implemented has been done correctly. So there's a certain level of trust in the long range committee and staff to get us to this point, and then we just need that kind of
support. And honestly, having that committee makes a big difference, because without that committee, folks on the planning board, this would be maybe the first time or second time they're hearing about it, but the committee did a lot of work.
The fact that you were there makes a big plus. So.
The interviews, they clearly rose to the top, in my opinion, during that interview process.
Yep. Yeah. Okay.
I've got one more question. On this map here, says we provided planning, urban design, and they list all the places. Did they say how many cities adopted their plan?
I don't recall a specific number. There was, that's a good question. I mean, they, you know, you definitely want something that is going to be, you know, not just produced, but actually, you know, adopted and then utilized. And that's probably even harder to quantify. You could have something adopted that people leave on their shelf and never look at. That's definitely what we're going to be aiming for.
They went back to look at exactly what the results of their analytical studies were.
I can speak anecdotally that, you know, I looked at some of these reference plans, and they appeared to be plans that the communities that were involved with them adopted. I didn't necessarily, you know, go looking for some of these and then, you know, not find them on the specific city page.
Yeah,
I would. It's just a web page search.
I mean, people asked me when I did it, so I didn't.
Matt, how is this plan going to be different from the county plan? And I can probably answer that somewhat by saying, well, all the development takes place in the city for connecting to the sewer. But who's the county using now? What are they paying? How does it compare to what city is planning to do?
I to be honest, I haven't done a full-scale comparison of who they're using. I couldn't tell you their consultant. I don't know their process, what number of meetings they've had, what the what kind of community engagement strategies they employed. I did take the survey, read a few newspaper articles. You know, I think you touched on this. The biggest difference is really going to be the focus, and you know, where they're really talking about farmland preservation and things of that nature, whereas, you know, we're going to be asking ourselves questions about density and height, and, you know, how to utilize the scarce resources of the land we have. And
does anyone here even know who they're using?
They're using Stewart, who did not submit a proposal.
I knew that we did not get one from the same firm. Yeah. So there was one firm that applied for both, but it's not one of the top choices.
I think, though, that during the public input process, personally, I think, you know, the two plans should complement each other.
Well, that Bolton and Mink actually brought that up.
As an appointee from the county in the ETJ, I really feel like you're developing two plans for the future. Basically the same. They need, in other words, you can't have one saying, well, we want to preserve farmland, and the other one saying we want no development.
Right.
There's 36,000 people coming here in the next 20 years, you know, and honestly, probably 75% of those need to be in the city.
Was Bolton and Mink the ones that actually talked about using the survey data from the county to inform what they were doing? Mm-hmm.
That's correct. So all 2 points. One, Fred just mentioned, they brought up the fact they had done the research and knew that 40% of the respondents to the county's survey lived within the city limits. And in an effort to not, give planning fatigue to the community, that they would, you know, utilize that data to start as a, you know, as a starting point, so that the community engagement from then on would be filling the gaps and would be, you know, very much tailored to city centric concerns, because you've already got a set of data from the county's project that you can build off of. So I thought that was insightful, showed that they had done research, and showed some creativity how to use data, and it showed some empathy for the community. You know, we just went through a whole, you know, year of meetings. Now you want us to come to another year of meetings? It can get old. So we need to be mindful of that. Second point, I came and brought an update to the Business Advisory Council earlier today at lunch, and they had the exact same feedback about collaborating and, making sure that we're as much as possible working hand in hand with the county's comprehensive plan, as well as Fletcher and Mills River. So that was a big part of their feedback as well. So we're hearing that from multiple sources to make sure those things are working together. So we will pass that along to whoever we choose.
Thank you. So discussion. If not, this board would like to make a recommendation to City Council for one of these firms.
Make a motion that we make a recommendation to City Council that the say it's in the again, Bolton.
And I think there was a recommended.
It's on the screen up there.
Oh, well, there you go. Okay.
Thank you. Make a recommendation that Bolton and Mink, along with their team of subcontractors, that contract for services to conduct the 2045 comprehensive plan for the city of Hendersonville.
I'll second that motion.
So this is a contract for services. It's not necessarily, this is a recommendation to the city council that the city move forward with a contract.
They award the contract to these folks.
Gotcha. Any other discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, that passes unanimously.
Thank you for the feedback. The other item, if you want me to go ahead and jump into it, this was kind of a last minute related to
the amendment. So when the state removed the emergency declaration because of the pandemic, we could no longer meet virtually in committees. Now, I'm not talking about a board meeting. I'm not talking about the second Monday of every month. I'm talking about committee meetings. So if I'm on a committee, which I'm on all of them, and I'm vacationing at the Outer Banks, I could easily jump on a one-hour committee meeting. I would try to come in person, but when I can't, I can't. And you folks are the same way. We're volunteers. However, when the emergency declaration ended, those virtual meetings went away. And this is just adding
the ability for committees to meet virtually if needed. And it's just verbiage in the rules of procedure that say that committees may conduct in person or through virtual participation.
Are you just making an announcement?
No, this is for discussion.
This would actually have to be voted on by an amendment.
This is an amendment to the rules of procedure for the City of Hendersonville's Planning Board.
Back during the emergency period, did we have any virtual meetings on committee?
Yes. I attended several.
Yes. So since then.
And that's why I mentioned because I was at the Outer Banks one time.
In addition to being at the Outer Banks, you could also just be busy at your office,
right,
or find it, you know,
have COVID,
troubling to have to go find a parking space and, you know, go move and go inside to a building. And it adds to everyone's time, staff time, you know, hosting an in-person meeting versus logging onto a virtual meeting. And we're doing this 6 times a month across all of our committees within our department alone.
They'll still be public?
Still open to public. Public notice is still the same.
Public can attend.
They can attend more easily. They can log into their computer and see what we're doing instead of having to come in person.
I'm ready to make a motion.
Okay.
We are, so what, I think we, how do we want to do this? I think it has to be considered for a certain amount of time. What we can do is probably take a consensus and then our direct staff to seek legal's review of this. And that will help us get the ball rolling, get it in front of legal, have them review it, and then hopefully come back next month with an actual.
I don't see anything wrong with this board wishing to amend the rules of their procedure at any given time. Certainly, if you know, the city lawyer wants to look at it, that's fine. And city council obviously needs to approve it.
City council does not have to approve it. This body can amend their rules under the rules of procedure. I believe there's a time, you know, it has to be presented at the previous meeting or advance of the meeting which was voted on.
Okay.
And so that's what we're doing tonight.
Okay.
And this will give us time to advisably get it reviewed by legal. So she may have some language tweaks, but this will at least get it on her desk, because if planning board says we want to do this, it's different than if you were not
voting. So are we still looking for a motion then?
I think you can make a motion to direct staff to pursue it.
Okay.
I'd like to make that motion to direct staff to change our rules and take it to the city attorney or whatever is necessary to allow committee meetings that may be conducted in person or through electronic virtual participation. Electronic virtual meetings shall require sufficient appropriate public notices.
Well stated. I'll second that.
Okay. Any discussion?
I just want to say one thing. City Council is getting real tired of my emailing them on this. County meetings are virtual. My EAC, Environmental Advisory Committee meeting last Thursday, was virtual. And my point to City Council when I sent the email last Wednesday night was, if the county can do it, why not us? Please have the city attorney explain.
Appointed board committees.
There actually is some language that other boards are using or have used, and it's been approved by the city attorney, or at least it had been at that time, and that was during the emergency session. But legally reviewed language that is about the board meeting and the rules they would have to follow if there's members that are virtual, participating virtually. And all those rules really apply to a board meeting. And you're not even asking for this board to have virtual participation at this time. And so I left out all those detailed, you know, you must state your name before you enter in, make a point of, add point of information or when you vote. And so I left all that out because these committees are really just working committees that are helping to provide some guidance. We're not voting, and it didn't seem to need to be that rigorous. So I've put very simple language together here that we'll see where it goes. But I think this motion will help move it forward.
Sure, thank you.
So who's going to make the decision that you guys wanted this next committee meeting to be virtual? Is it up to
So I'll jump in. Yeah. So this was discussed at the council meeting last week, and staff attorney requested the opportunity to craft the language, and council directed staff, the manager, and the city attorney to continue to have the primary committees and boards meet in person, but that's to look into subcommittees meetings. So basically, when we get the language from city attorney that is legally acceptable, and to your point, Neil, a different attorney interprets the same thing differently. But you know, once we have that, and I think that's the direction we're heading in, then we would bring that back and amend the rules of procedure accordingly. So I think it's probably, you know, not unreasonable to expect that to occur within the next month or so.
Okay, we have a motion. We have a second. Any other discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Two unanimous decisions. Okay, and we are going to adjourn.
Yeah, good.
Need a motion to adjourn?
Okay.
There we go.
This is a democracy.
Motion.